than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
Once again, we want to thank everybody for coming out. Hotep, Assalamu Alaikum, Shalawa, Shalom to all my brothers and sisters, to all my black beautiful kings and queens. This is a very beautiful event, anticipating the event rather, you know, Unmasked, Superheroes of African Origin. So my brother David, the beloved one from InfoDen, is going to drop some powerful knowledge information. We just want to ask guys, man, that you be respectful, peaceful. You know, we all family here. Any questions, you know, that you want to ask, please, after the presentation, please let it be basic with this topic here, you know, so we want to have a good time. Let's get right into it, you know, at this time. All praise to the Most High, Yahweh Bahashim, Yahweh Shah, and all the blessings flow into all the ancestors, everyone here. We want to just give thanks and praise what praise is due at this time, all right? Peace. So we're going to get right into it. I'm going to present a brother who y'all know from the neighborhood. He came up from the ranks, been through the mills and rough edges, you know, a pastor, a brother, a friend, a mentor, no other than Piso, Pastor Michael Peace. Let's please receive him. Come on, I say. Nice power, brother.
Peace be unto you, my brothers and sisters. We give God honor to the Most High God, and I'm so grateful to be here on this afternoon. I got something I want to recite to y'all. Normally, I don't recite like this. I recite, like, I take my time, I make sure that I got it all down packed. Like, I'm like one of them type of OCD perfectionist type of guys, because I believe performance is important. You can be saying something real important, but if your delivery is not right, you'll lose the audience. So I believe in keeping the audience's attention. So I do ask y'all to pardon me, but this message has to be carried, so I'm gonna do my best like this, all right, y'all? They said, give this unjust killing a few more days. We'll watch them destroy their own neighborhoods. And once again, their rage will die out. Then we'll go back to their hood, pull out our guns and announce we have openings for darker skin, unarmed moving targets, preferably males. Everyone qualifies. No need to try out. It seems that they don't need a justifiable reason to kill us. But when they do, they flip it and go run and get every news channel to broadcast the background of the murdered one's past after they've been slaughtered like a worthless animal. Yeah, I'm angry for real, B. How in the world are they constantly found not guilty? Easy, the whole system is filthy. From the realtor doing the realty, possibly running for president, to the licensed killer, the jury, and the ones that the jury set free. We gotta wake up, brothers, and recognize that there's still a war going on. This ain't hateration. This is the results of a lopsided judicial system that's corrupting our nation. The murders of unarmed blacks and Hispanics seem to be the infatuation. The only clarification is that they know if we ever work together, we will be the most powerful nation. So they hit us with fouls that's flagrant. And then they say, so be it. And the referees, you know, the grand jury and the judges, continue to turn their head and act like they don't even see it. That's why I tell my people, get your education. Don't be embarrassed. Let Christ in your life. Live better than the average. Anger don't win fights. We gotta outsmart the savage by upgrading our spiritual and intellectual status. Go back to school, get your AA, your BA, your MBA, your master's, your PhD, and maintain a high GPA so you can open your own business and you can hire your own folk and you can empower your own community, and then your people won't have to walk around broke. Keep your mind clear. Don't drink nothing, sniff, shoot, or smoke nothing. So if they come your way, you'll be prepared to show them something. See, there's still a war going on. We know about the war overseas. We know about Israel. We know about Iraq. We know about Iran. We know about the things people are doing that goes along with Satan's plan, but I understand that many of y'all don't under or overstand that there's a roar, inner city war, a real plot against the black man. Look, he's too powerful, lock him up. He needs to be segregated. We'll show him how we really feel about him being emancipated. He's too strong. We want you to kill him. We want you to stress him out, overbill him, empty the clip, reload, and then refill him, because one clip won't kill him.
Come on.
It seems as if he's built to last. You gotta check his past. He has outstanding bravery. Look how he came through slavery. Look, heroin in the 60s, dust in the 70s, and crack in the 80s. Look, that left motherless and fatherless babies. Look, that was raised on tasteless gravy. Meat was a maybe. And the baby that was raised brazy, she's now having a baby. Baby daddy is locked up on a bogus stop and frisk. Cops put the gun to his head. Wake up, brothers, they want us dead. They want the black man extinct. That's why they lock us up at rapid rates, cock the hammer and fill us with heat. But they don't care who kills us. They would prefer it was our own peeps from the street. It could be from the suit wearer to the saggy pants wearer with no crease, from the skinny to the obese, from Shaquana to Maurice. Look, but because we continue to survive everything, look like they gave the job to the police.
Boyde's running them up, let's go. Boyde's running them up, let's go.
And they got upset due to no more stop and frisk and went straight to murder. That's the craziest thing that I ever heard of. Trust me, I'm not anti-cop, anti-corruption. An oath was taken to uphold the law. And in that promise, that's how they should function. That was a commercial. Now back to my regularly scheduled program. So we need to do something, my brothers and sisters. We need to eliminate black men shooting black men. We need to eliminate cops shooting young black men. We need to eliminate wannabe cops shooting young black men. Touch your neighbor and say Zimmerman. Look at what happened to little brother Trey, Sean Bell and Freddie Gray, Romali Graham. He died from the cocked hammer right in front of his little brother and in front of his nana. Eric Gardner was choked out right in front of the camera. No grand jury indictments. None of them jokers went to the slammer. Amadou Diallo, unarmed. Kamani Gray, he was unarmed. Timothy Stansberry, he was unarmed. Sean Bell, he was unarmed. To be continued.
Powerful words from the brother. Well, we appreciate that. All right. Without further ado, this is the night, the hour y'all all been waiting for. Our dearly beloved brother's about to break down some information, some knowledge. So please, we ask, take your pens and pads out, because it's about to get hot in here. About to get hot in here, y'all. We're going to go deep into some things here. So we're going to present the brother. I'm gonna give a nice salutation, big round of applause for our brother, David, beloved. Come on, let's receive him. Let's receive him.
All right, y'all. Pastor Peace, man.
Yes, sir.
I didn't know you were coming in with it like that, brother.
Okay.
Hey, you warmed up the stage for me there.
Yes, sir.
All right. First, I want to thank everybody for coming. I know it's, sometimes when you promote these kind of events, you don't really know how many people show up. You know, you put the notice out there, and hopefully, you know, you get a response. So I would like to thank everybody who showed up today, which is greatly appreciated. Give yourselves a round of applause, definitely. I'm not going to spend too much time on an introduction, but as you can see, tonight's presentation is dealing with superheroes. It's called Unmasked, Modern Superheroes and Their African Origins. Now, why is this presentation so important? Basically, we got to reclaim our stories. You know what I'm saying? Each one of them stories that they present, whether it be in a movie, video game, comic book, they're all our stories. You know what I'm saying? And the more we let it rock, the more they're going to be enriched, the more we lost. Because they creating a whole industry based on these stories that, you know, Some of us may think of it as just a trivial, you know, comic book story, but these things are actually based on facts of people who actually live, and we're going to show and prove that. Seeing yourself in these superheroes. You know, growing up, I was big into comic books. X-Men, Superman, Spider-Man, I was big into the comic book art and to the stories, so I was into all those books, and I always look for me, you know what I'm saying? I look for people like me, and you know, you have a couple of characters out there, but they don't really push them the way they push the X-Mens and the Supermans and the Spider-Mans, and you'll see one character in there, and you'll get happy. Oh yeah, they got a Fireman, a black Fireman in the comic book. You know, you'll get happy on these little victories, not knowing that the whole damn book is based on your story. So we want to encourage also independent research on things and not just accept things for face value. We want people to go back in those books and study these things because it's all there, man. Once you connect those dots, it's clear as day. Let's go to the next slide. All right. Oh, yes. Yeah, so just a quick disclaimer because don't want to get sued. You know, all these characters are not owned by me. They're owned by DC and Marvel. DC and Marvel are the main corporates. They each one of these writers and artists, when told and asked, you know, what is your inspiration for these characters, they always keep it really vague. They never really give the full credit to where they get these ideas and these stories, man. So, but we're going to get into that. The superheroes that we're putting on trial, we're going to put them on trial, man. Yeah, we got to, man, because they're getting away with a lot. They're getting away with a lot because, you know, a lot of kids damn near worship some of these. I was victim to that too. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, you a kid, you get into trouble, a lot of us won't say, oh, Jesus, come help me. No, they try to envision what would they do if they become Superman or Batman or Wonder Woman. Because if I was Superman, I'll get out this situation X, Y, and Z. Right. So in a sense, you kind of worship it. You are starting to embody these characters. But you see that they're white, then that means the only superheroes are white. You know what I'm saying? So you're going to have to become white. But we're going to get into Shazam, X-Men, Thor, Cosmic Suit Spider-Man. That was the Black Suit Spider-Man. Wonder Woman, Superman, and Batman. We're going to say Batman for last. Just a brief history in terms of superheroes. A lot of this you guys can research on your own. I'm not going to get too much into the history of the actual superheroes. But all these characters, they came about during the Depression, during World War II. This is the time that immigrant Jews, immigrant Italians were living in slums, and you know, just like some of our people now, they needed an escape. They needed something that they could gravitate towards, and they could let their imagination run wild. A lot of these characters came about because of that. And it's popular culture now, you know what I'm saying? People are all fascinated by these characters. People want to embody these characters. They're making money. Video games are selling off the roof. You know, the profits. You know, I just threw some numbers out there. You know, you can just get this from Google, whatever the case may be. But it's just to show that it's, you know, movies from the Bible and Kemet, ancient Egypt, whatever you want to call it, those things are on the decline. These things are on their way up. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you had Gods of Egypt, you had some other movies. No one went to go see the movies. But everybody's going to go see Batman, everybody's going to go see Iron Man, Thor, Captain America. So that's telling you something. They replaced those characters. They replaced those biblical characters. They replaced those characters on the walls. We now want to be like these people here. We want to be like Iron Man. We want to be like the Avengers.
Chosen from among all others by the immortal elders Solomon, Hercules, Atlas, Zeus, Achilles, Mercury, Billy Batson and his mentor travel the highways and byways of the land on a never-ending mission to right wrongs, to develop understanding, and to seek justice for all. In time of dire need, young Billy has been granted the power by the immortals to summon awesome forces at the utterance of a single word.
Dwayne Rock Johnson. 2019, they're slated to come out with a new Shazam movie, and they're gonna have Dwayne Rock Johnson as the lead. We're gonna run with Shazam first as who we're gonna present. I don't know if a lot of y'all are familiar with this character, he was really considered the first big superhero, even before Superman. This is way back. This is, you're talking about late 30s, 40s. This was the character that really received that marketing push in terms of all the superheroes. If you guys don't know anything of the background in terms of the character, Shazam, supposed to be acronyms for Solomon, Hercules, Atlas, Zeus, Achilles, and Mercury. He's supposed to embody these characters. He's supposed to embody these deities. Right when you say the word Shazam, from a little boy, he springs up and turns into a full-grown man with all these powers. Right? Okay, now let's get into the story of Shazam. Right? The origin of Shazam. The kid's name is Billy Batson, right? Adopted by the Vasquez family, paternal mother, Marilyn. His adoptive sister's married Batson. Young Billy meets an old Egyptian wizard, an underground cavern with seven statues. The old wizard sees potential in young Billy and grants him powers. If you guys are familiar with the story, he goes into this tunnel. As you can see, these are stills from the original comics from his origin. And you can already tell from the look of that train station, that train, they got some real symbolic, esoteric symbols on there anyway.
Yes.
And then when he goes into the cave, he's confronted by seven statues and seven cannons, right? He's adopted by the Vasquez family, right? Me, I like to decode every little thing, man, because nothing is put out there just for no reason. They give you information for you to put it together, right? When you start saying Vasquez, mother was Marilyn, sister was married, come on, they pushing you in the face with this Mary thing. You know what I'm saying? In terms of the people who are associated with him. Seven statues. Potential powers. Is anybody here familiar with or aware of Santeria or things of that nature in terms of dealing with African spirituality? So, I mean, if you look at this, this should be ringing you some bells, you know what I'm saying? Because if you go to a lot of Latino families, and this is the Vasquez family, you're going to see candles, you know what I'm saying? Some of them might be into this kind of stuff, you know what I'm saying? But that, I'm just going by assumption just from misinformation, but let's go deep into this information, right? Vasquez comes from the Latin word vasco, meaning crow. The crows are symbolic to gifts of ancient wisdom and sacred law. Now check that out. He was adopted by the Vasquez family. The word Vasquez means crow. And the crow is symbolic to something spiritual is about to happen. He's about to enter something. Just like that movie, The Omen. I don't know if you've seen that from way back in the day. Every time that crow appears, something bad happens. Either something bad or something good. The old Egyptian wizard in which he meets in that cave represents knowledge and initiation, and he sees potential in young Billy. And a lot of these secret societies, a lot of societies, you know, there's always an elder figure who instills that knowledge to a young initiate. So that's kind of representing that. It's young Billy enters this cave, and he meets an old man who has all this knowledge. Confronted by the seven statues and seven candles, which are symbolic to the seven African powers. Does anybody know what the seven African powers are? Let's get into what the seven African powers are. Boom. For those who are familiar with Santeria, or some of the Voodoo religion, things of that nature, seven African powers are these figures you see here, which really have deeper meanings, other characters in which they represent. The whole, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the whole basis of Santeria was when we were brought here in slave ships, still want to remain with our spirituality, we had to disguise our gods, our people that we dealt with characters that the Catholic religion recognized. So we wouldn't be looked at from the slave masters as practicing something that they didn't really understand or didn't all want. So that's what the seven African powers are. And if we go back, we notice that the old man has seen potential in young Billy. And in Spanish, they call Siete Potencia Africana. Seven potential African powers. Let's go to the next part. Boom. So we got the what they wanted to appear, but then this is what it actually is. These are the characters of the seven African powers. We want to highlight this because it's very symbolic to Billy going into the cave, looking at these seven candles. That number seven is always standing out. Matter of fact, you're going to see that's going to be a trend on this presentation. A lot of that number seven stands out in damn near every ideology you could think of, whether it be the Bible, Quran, ancient Kemet. That number seven pops up, and it's special to a lot of schools of thought. Again, these are the seven African powers. Remember, we had to disguise these deities and put them into a way that would be acceptable by the slave master, right? So let's go into this character. Marilyn, Mary, that's obvious references to the Bible. If they're giving you Mary, Marilyn, they're beating you in the head with that. They want you to think a certain way, right? The transformation from young Billy, he goes from a 12-year-old kid to a 30-year-old grown man. Now, where does that sound familiar?
Jesus.
That's right. Ancient Egypt, the priests wore white and gold around their waist. Right? What does Shazam wear? Right? Now, check this out. I'm trying to see what Shazam meant in any kind of language. I couldn't really find it. But I did find Shazam, which in Hebrew means brown. Right? That's gonna play into a key thing in a few seconds. Known as God of Gods. That's what his character is known, right? Check this out. So he's already wearing the Kemetic garments. They're trying to make him, package him as like a Jesus kind of character. Let's see if there's any reference to this in the Bible. In the midst of the seven candlesticks, those are seven candlesticks he approached when he went into that cave. One like unto him, the Son of Man, clothed with garments down to the foot and grit around the paps with golden girdle. There go the golden right there. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his feet like unto fine brass. Well, got everything but that. As if they were burning the furnace, and his voice sound as many waters. That's when he says Shazam, and that he turns into the character. But they try to market like a Jesus kind of a character, you know what I'm saying, to you, embodying all these principles and repackaging and putting it right back to you. He fits the bill, except for one thing. Shazam is brown. You know what I'm saying? That's like if you're going to come up with a Shazam character, it has to look more like that. And I don't know if anybody remembers this episode of Good Time. That was one of my favorite episodes right there.